Welcome. Well, you're at home with Jim and Joy, and you are an important part of our EWTN family. And we're delighted that you have welcomed us into your home. You know, we would love to hear from you. So send us an email with a question or a comment to jimandjoy@ewtn.com. Well, today we're going to re-air a show. The great guest that we had on that show is Kevin Burke. Now, Kevin is the co-founder of Rachel's Vineyard Ministries. He's a pastoral associate with Priest for Life. You can go to their great website, rachelsvineyard.org. And Kevin's specialty is talking about the trauma that men experience emotionally and spiritually after they have participated in an abortion. Yes.
Well, he and Teresa have founded this Rachel Vineyard Retreat Weekends, the largest post-abortion healing ministry in the world. And the impact upon men who've gone the way of abortion or have been impacted by abortion. You know, there's three types of men, at least. There are those that have pushed their mate into abortion. There are those who were kind of like, well, whatever you decide to do, I'll support you in that. And then there's those that resisted and didn't want that abortion to take place. They are impacted. There is trauma. They too are touched by guilt and shame. And men in particular, Kevin will share with us, really experience anger with themselves and with others. And Kevin speaks about the Garden of Eden and Adam's not standing up to defend Eve against the temptation of the serpent. And it's the same thing in abortion, that many times the men don't stand up and protect and defend. And once they understand, I was involved with the killing of my own child, they're in despair. They're angry. They can medicate themselves and on and on and on. Rachel's Vineyard, the work of Kevin Burke, really helps these guys to come to terms with the truth and to see themselves now as the Lord sees them in mercy, grace, and forgiveness, and to be witnesses to the gospel of life. Kevin is doing an absolutely incredible work healing the father's hearts.
And one of the things that Kevin shared that was so beautiful was that 90% of the men who are in prison are post-abortive. So that, you know, he went in to do prison ministry, and really, like, that was one thing that they all had in common. And things, how their life from abortion changes you forever. The woman and the guy and the child. And so this is, Kevin is just outstanding with his healing and hope that he offers.
The show today is about healing. Rachelsvineyard.org, it's there for you men who've experienced abortion, women who've experienced abortion. It's going to be a powerful show. We'll be right back. Don't go away.
Welcome to At Home with Jim and Joy. You are a dear friend, you and your beloved wife, Teresa. So tell us a little bit about yourself, you know, the normal part of your life, and then how the two of you got involved in this ministry.
Well, Teresa and I will be married 30 years.
Congratulations.
In August. We have five children, aged 30 to 17.
Wow.
And one grandchild.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
William.
Beautiful.
Isn't that the best?
That's a great joy.
Yeah.
And I'm a licensed social worker. My concentration and training was in counseling, marriage, family counseling. So that's my background.
Right.
And then how we got into this, when Teresa and I got married, post-abortion healing was not on our personal or professional radar at all. Teresa was in graduate school. I had already had my degree in social work, and Teresa was in graduate school for psychology. We were just starting a family. And she was running an eating disorder group as part of her internship and training. It was supervised by a psychiatrist. It was an eating disorder center. So these women all have anorexia and bulimia. The subject of abortion came up one evening in the group, and it was very volatile. And it turns out that, you know, let's say about 80% of the participants had abortions. You can read about this in Teresa's book, Forbidden Grief.
Right.
And she went to her supervising psychiatrist, said this was like a bomb going off. when this surfaced, I think we need to really talk more about this. And the psychiatrist looked at her and he actually wagged his finger and he said, this is an eating disorder group. I forbid you to address this topic. It has nothing to do with their symptoms. Now, if you know Teresa, you know that at that point...
It's not good to wag a finger in her face.
That was going to be her life's mission and vocation. So it's interesting how here he's trying to shut down healing, but this actually opened a door. The Holy Spirit opened a door in Teresa's heart and mind and led her to then to look at, I know there's other women like this. I want to begin to help them.
So when these women, however it came about, started sharing with each other, they found that they had abortion in common, many of them.
Yes.
And so what was the conversation in that area? What was coming out of their conversation saying, well, this is, you know, what we're not finding out there to help us? Or what was the conversation about?
The conversation, well, it started because there was a phone call from a former partner that she had the abortion with. He obviously didn't support the abortion and was angry and hurt by that. He was dealing with this anger in a very abusive way. He was calling her up and he was calling on the phone and calling her a murderer and doing things to try to hurt her. So you see how destructive this can become. So she shared that. And then there was a lot of anger from those who have had abortions. He has no right to do that. And another participant said, I have a right to do what I want with my body. And of course, her body was out of control with an eating disorder, not associating her abortion with perhaps contributing to that. Another participant tried to change the subject, did not want to talk about it, which is our whole culture. Let's not even address this. So she was distracting. Look at my sweater, isn't it pretty? Another individual got up and just left, and they heard the car screech in the parking lot. That represents this is such a sensitive and painful area of loss that it's very difficult to even talk about it. So you had all these different manifestations of how that wound just leads to very painful and powerful emotions. But what do you do with all that?
The title of the book, Forbidden Grief.
Forbidden Grief.
Was this a part of the conversation among the people? Or is this something that just kind of came out? I'm speaking about, did they get that they needed to grieve, or that people don't want to talk about this, or is this what Teresa learned through the process, that grief work is very important to the process, but really nobody wants to hear it, or you don't need to do it?
Well, a very important first step happened that night, a preliminary very first step, which is just acknowledging that this is an issue. There's some really powerful and painful feelings associated with that. But how do you take that powerful emotional energy And how do you process that? And can you do it in strictly a psychological healing approach? What Teresa found early on as she began to explore this in her counseling is that this is a soul wound. So if you just apply even the best psychology to this wound, that's not going to be enough. You need to have an integrated, and this was Teresa's genius and the Holy Spirit working with her. You need an integrated emotional and spiritual program to bring a deeper healing to this type of wound, because it's a complicated grief. This isn't a normal experience of grief. When we have a normal experience of grief, we can talk to each other about it. We have rituals and exercises we go through, and we have the support of family and friends. With abortion, as you well know from your ministry.
Well, we want you to kind of unpack this unique grief and the inability of so many people to be able to find places where they can articulate this, get in touch with the people who can help them. But I understand that we have a caller, and this is someone that has association with Rachel's Vineyard ministry. And so why don't you tell us more about this call?
Yes, Rob was very kind to share with us today about he was involved in a number of different abortion decisions and procedures. And he also found healing through Rachel's Vineyard. So I'm really very grateful for Rob for calling in and being willing to share with us.
Rob, you're at home with Jim and Joy. We're so blessed to have you with us today. And so just feel free to share with us and our family.
Okay, thank you very much for having me on there today. My story, unfortunately, started about four decades ago while I was in college. It was with three separate partners. We were using birth control every time, but it failed all three times. And together, without pressuring each other, each time we made the unfortunate and irreversible decision to discontinue the pregnancies and seek abortions. When we went to the clinics, the counselors were all pretty much the same. They told us that we would be sad for a short period of time. unfortunately, in my case, that sadness has lasted decades. During the procedures, I was present with each girl. I went into the room with them, watched everything that was going on. And quite honestly, even today, I'm still haunted by the sights and sounds when I hear a vacuum cleaner or see clear tubes. It gives me flashbacks back to that time. Shortly after that period of college, I decided that I should do something about this because the pain was just getting too much for me. So I actually decided to have a vasectomy. And it wasn't until many years later, in retrospect and with age, I think my decision to have the vasectomy was basically due to God giving me three just incredible gifts. And unfortunately, I literally threw them away. And internally, I felt like I did not deserve another chance. I had been given three, and that was enough. So for decades, I was just sort of motoring along, dealing with a loss and internal pain. And it actually wasn't until just a few years ago, I happened to be talking to a priest on a completely unrelated topic, and just out of the blue, something I hadn't thought about for decades, I just started to cry uncontrollably, and we quickly got to the root cause, and that was the abortions that I had suffered decades ago. Wow. Thankfully, this priest was pretty well versed with Rachel's Vineyard. He sent me towards the website, and I got on there and made the decision to sign up for the retreat. There wasn't one in New Hampshire where I'm located, but there was one in Maine, so I signed up for that. Very scared. I was the only male in the group, but like everybody else that showed up, ages from 18 all the way to more than 70, we were all terrified. But the events that happened in the weekend, you can't describe them in words. It was just absolutely amazing, a healing event. And by the time Sunday came around, no one wanted to leave the building. And I can't, and anyone out there, any males that are having the loss or sort of the pain that I've been discussing, I can't recommend you enough to get on rachelsvineyard.org, get a retreat, sign up, commit yourself to going, and let the healing begin. I think that Kevin and Teresa have not only done a good job, they've done an outstanding job of putting this program together. And I've been very blessed by the Maine team, the state of Maine, to be on their chapter. And it's a blessing every time I get to attend.
Rob, thank you so much. And we're so sorry for your losses. But what a loving testimony, what a hopeful testimony. And many lives are going to be touched because of that. What do you hear in Rob's sharing? How is his story classic in any way, or what?
I'm so deeply grateful for him sharing that, because we're just beginning to recognize in our society, just beginning to recognize that women can experience that procedure as a traumatic loss. A lot of people don't think that a man can also experience emotional trauma. But what he articulated very beautifully is that when you're in that procedure room, and I talked to a man the other day who was in the procedure room, and he had the same exact kind of traumatic reaction. They see the contents of their baby and the blood go up into the tube, into the jar. Right. So when he sees medical tubing, when he hears a vacuum, it triggers those memories and very painful feelings. So that it's clearly, that's a textbook definition of psychological trauma reactions, what he described. So in addition to that, if you don't have healing after that trauma, it's very common to repeat themes of that trauma. And again, I learned this from the master, which is Teresa. Teresa really developed this whole idea of traumatic repetition, and you can read about that again in Forbidden Grief. But that if you don't heal those themes and those memories, those feelings, that whole event, if you don't go through a healing process from all that powerful emotional energy, you then find yourself repeating those themes again in your life and subsequent relationships. And you find yourself again at the abortion clinic. And each time you feel more and more ashamed, you're more and more traumatized. Sometimes you master the trauma by becoming numb and pretending like it's no big thing. So some women have 3, 5, 12, even 20 abortions. And of course the abortion industry is very happy to take their money.
Right.
So that repetition is a powerful part. Now, we want to stop abortions before they happen. But if we can get healing of that initial abortion loss, we're going to save many more babies and many more people from acting out on that trauma in their lives.
So, Kevin, yeah. One of the things that Rob shared was after he had the three abortions that it is the self-mutilation and the self-hate
yes.
that he then took himself to have a vasectomy.
Mm-hmm.
How common is that in men that are post-abortive?
I can't tell you that, you know, the amount of men that do that, but I would say it's a very common theme.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see that kind of self-destructive behavior, though, in other ways. They'll sabotage their relationships.
Oh, yeah.
They'll throw themselves into work, and at the expense of the relationships with their living children. They'll wonder, they may not recognize connections to their abortion, so they'll wonder at midlife, I've been working like crazy. I throw myself into my career, and here, 20 years later, I'm estranged from my children. My wife hates me. Like, what the heck? And then and then the bottom drops out, and sometimes they're at risk for suicide. And a lot, again, they may not connect that to that abortion loss, but it can be a factor in what they're experiencing. So, yeah, that's self-destructive. That's yeah. that's with men and women.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's many creative ways, sadly, yeah. mm-hmm. that men and women find to shame and hurt themselves yeah. and to reenact those themes in their relationships.
Yeah. Can you speak about contraception, abortion, the relationship?
His parents were clearly, I don't know a lot of information about his parents, but they were clearly children of the sexual revolution. And so they were very permissive in allowing their children to be sexually active, sadly. So that was the message he grew up with. But he also received or had the message himself that, well, I need to do this responsibly. And so he saw contraception as being the responsible way to be sexually active. But we hear this so many times on retreat weekends, and you're familiar with this as well, Jim and Joy. Abortion is clearly used as a backup for mm-hmm. contraception mm-hmm. failure. And there's such a relationship between getting involved in relationships intimately before you're ready to deal with the consequences and have the maturity and the trust and the communication so that you can, yeah. you know, make the right decisions for yeah. life. So many people are so immature when they're making their decisions. And of course, the contraception does fail, both the various kinds yeah. in various ways can yeah. fail. And it's tragic that he was in that position.
Mm-hmm. And the mindset is developed. I mean, contraception is against conception. So then we're seeing and hearing people that are saying, I took steps because I was against this. Mm-hmm. And now they have this kind of odd or wrongful conception. And so it's antagonistic. It's like I was saying beforehand, I was being responsible, I didn't want this, and now this has happened. Therefore, this like justifies, in their thinking, going ahead and doing this. I was being responsible. This is here. This shouldn't be here. This is a wrongful conception. Therefore, this is what I do. And we see this again and again.
It brings to mind to me, I often have this image when I'm listening to men, when I'm on retreats and I'm listening to the stories. I always think of the original sin.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I think, and unfortunately, I think today, a lot of people look at that as kind of a whimsical myth,
mm-hmm.
you know, a cute little story. But boy,
So what does the original sin have to do?
It's never been more relevant to today. That apple, you know, not respecting God's providence over our sexuality, over life itself. When we don't respect that providence, when we listen to the serpent, you know, and it opens the door to so much suffering. I think in particular, this is a very important analogy for men. So many abortion decisions, so many stories you hear in a Rachel's Vineyard retreat, and you hear the man's role in that abortion. It echoes in many ways the experience of Adam in the garden. Now, when Eve was facing the serpent, and I have to give Scott Hahn credit for illuminating this for me,
mm-hmm.
he talks about the word snake is not so great of an interpretation of that Hebrew word. It's more dragon, like the dragon in Revelation.
Mm.
This diabolical, you know, very intelligent, you know, devious force that Eve is facing. And when Eve faces that, is confronted with that serpent, where's Adam?
Mm-hmm.
And of course, he's right there.
Yeah.
But he's silent. And then when the Lord comes down and holds him accountable, he blames her. So in many abortion decisions, and this is a very painful, I don't say this was accusation. I say this because I know this is where men hurt. So many men are like Adam in that situation, and she is facing that very difficult decision, and they may either say, it's your decision, which is often a death sentence for the baby.
Right.
And the woman feels like, well, you're not going to be there for me. Or they push and subtly coerce her. Or there's outright aggression and violence toward the woman
right.
to abort. And in all those situations, you're pushing the woman and your unborn baby into the hands of the serpent.
Right.
And when men realize it, maybe they're hearing this now and just realizing, that's what I did. Don't despair.
Amen.
That's a real pain, though, because that's attacked a fundamental identity of who we are as men. It attacks us where we should be defending life.
Kevin, I've been following your ministry, yes. and you seem to be going to prison a lot. What's going
yes.
on with your prison work?
Absolutely. Rachel's Vineyard is in Florida, Diocese of Palm Beach. Donna Gardner has a beautiful ministry there, outreach. She goes into the prisons. What we're finding in the prisons, this is very important. These men, and I've talked to a number of them I had a chance to visit, they've experienced profound father wounds, neglect, abuse, abandonment. Almost all of them have had serious father wounds. When they then participate in an abortion decision, they become both, they identify both as victim and perpetrator because they have experienced an emotional abortion, in a sense. They were emotionally aborted by their father. And that's a profound wound. And then they become perpetrator and participate in the death of their child. Now, they don't understand this till the other side of healing. Mm-hmm. But emotionally, this is explosive. And it's part of what leads them into violence and acting out behavior that gets them into prison. It's not the only issue, but what they find in their healing is that it was a powerful spark that took place in their life because it connects to that father wound. The beautiful thing is, this is from the men. They meet God the Father who loves them as a father. That's the first part of their retreat journey in prison. And that's profound for them. And then they heal that relationship with their unborn child. We see that healing then in the relationships with their living children. Mm-hmm. They're restored as men. One of the men said to me, the Lord is an African-American man, maybe in his 50s. He said, the Lord reached into my chest. Yeah. He took out my heart. Mm-hmm. And he gave me a new heart. And I was like, wow.
It's biblical.
Yes. So that's a beautiful healing. And think of the application in our area, in our communities where there's so much father loss and father abandonment and men are struggling and drawn to violence. Mm-hmm. Abortion healing can be such a vehicle of healing in those communities.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
Well, Kevin, this has been a profound time. And we're so very, very grateful for your presence with us, and we do have to have you back on because you just begun to unpack it and you've given to us a real way of healing and of hope with Rachel's Vineyard. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. I'm so grateful.
God bless you. Well, Kevin showed us how men can certainly be harmed by abortion. If you need healing, check out Rachel's Vineyard Ministries. Now, please join us on Wednesday when our guest will be Father Augustino Torres. Now, he is the president and founder of Corazon Puro. And remember, you are always at home with Jim and Joy. You are an important part of our EWTN family. God bless you, and bye now.